fragrant smell on the person or on the clothes of this individual. And going into a blacksmith's workshop, even though the person may not be a blacksmith himself, may not participate and involve himself in the work, and may not touch or do anything, still, because of the atmosphere, the environment, and the climate, when this person emerges from the blacksmith's workshop, to some degree he will have been affected either with a suit on his clothes, or if there's no suit on his clothes, then at least by the smell, the colour, and the of the smoke and fire. So a person is influenced by the environment to such a degree, even though there's no apparent interaction involved or involvement to be seen. In fact, if we go a step further, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has explained in the hadith how animals affect human beings. How the company of animals has a very deep and profound influence and effect on a person. And not just on their clothes or on their appearance. No, actually on their character. Animals can have an effect on a person's character. In one hadith related by Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi, as well as others in their books of hadith, as part of a longer hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, وَالْفَخْرُ وَالْخُيَلَاء فِي أَهْلِ الْخَيْلِ والإبل والفدادين أهل الوبر والسكينة في أهل الغنم. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says that boastfulness and arrogance are in the people of the of horses and of camels, and of the people of the desert, and tranquility and calmness are in the people of the sheep. The meaning of the people of the camel and the people of the sheep is that those who herd camels and who look after horses and spend time with horses and spend time with camels, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said they are arrogant and proud and boastful. Boastfulness, pride and arrogance are to be found in the very character and the mentality and personality of these people who associate themselves and who have prolonged exposure to horses and to camels. And conversely, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, there is tranquility in shepherds, those who herd flocks of sheep, or who spend time, who are exposed in a prolonged way to sheep, they are tranquil and they are calm, very collected and composed. Subhanallah. Imagine, arrogance is a very criminal offense. Arrogance is a major sin in the sight of Allah. It's one of the greatest diseases of the heart. In fact, many ulama have explained that it's the root cause of all the diseases of the heart. And when we look at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's creation of Sayyidina Adam alayhi salatu wassalam and his subsequent instruction to the rest of creation to prostrate to Sayyidina Adam alayhi salatu wassalam and Shaytan's refusal to prostrate to him. When we look at this story in the Holy Quran, Allah Azza wa Jal asks Shaytan that why did you refuse to prostrate to Adam when I instructed you to? Now people often say that this was the first sin. This was his first act of rebellion. The first sin was that he refused to prostrate to Sayyidina Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. Yes, that was a physical manifestation of sin. But this wasn't his first sin. It was the first physical manifestation of sin. But the sin that actually preceded this sin, the sin that actually instigated this rebellion, the sin that caused him to refuse to prostrate to Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, even upon the command of Allah, was a sin of the heart, and that was a sin of arrogance. He felt proud and arrogant that he was better than Sayyidina Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, therefore why should he prostrate to him? So it was this sin of the heart, this sin of arrogance, that actually preceded the act of rebellion and refusal to prostrate to Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. And Allah Azza wa Jalla, when he asked him, he replied by saying, Allah quotes Shaytan in the Quran, Allah says, when Allah said to him, why did you refuse to prostrate? He said, أَنَا خَيْرٌ مِّنْ خَلَقْتَنِي مِنْ نَارٍ وَخَلَقْتَهُ مِنْ طِينٍ, that I am better than him. You created me from fire and you created him from clay. How can I, created of fire, prostrate to him, created of clay, when I am better than him? So it was this thought that I am better than him, this pride and arrogance, that ultimately led him to rebel against Allah's command. So the first sin was arrogance. It's the root cause of many sins, and it's the root cause of many of the diseases, if not all of the diseases of the heart. And yet, subhanAllah, a person can easily catch the disease of arrogance from animals. Be in the company of camels, be around horses. Horses being very strong, graceful, powerful, fast animals. Horses are strong. Horses are strong-headed. Horses are proud. And camels are in a different league altogether. Camels are extremely stubborn, obstinate, rebellious, very difficult to control, very arrogant, and totally unpredictable. Now, these characteristics of the camel and the horse are actually transferred to a human being when the human being spends time around these animals. And when we look on the other side, look at sheep, extremely soft-natured, docile, lovable, cuddly. We think well of them. They are very docile, servile, humble, compliant. As I was explaining earlier today, one guard dog, one small poodle can actually manage and herd an entire flock of sheep. And it takes sometimes 10 men to control one camel. And that's why this tranquility, this calmness, this compliance, this civility and humbleness, this humility in the sheep is all of these things, all of these characteristics and inner spiritual qualities are actually transferred to a human being who has prolonged exposure to the sheep. So subhanAllah, think of it. Sheep have such an effect on men. Camels have such an effect on men. All animals have such an effect on men. And that is why when we say we are what we eat, it's not just about physically being what we are because of what we have physically consumed. But we should also realize that the flesh and the meat of animals also has an effect on our mentality and also on our spirituality. That's why Allah has made one of the reasons and one of the wisdoms of making permissible some kinds of meat and making haram and impermissible other kinds of meat. This is part of Allah's wisdom. We do not know that some meats are haram, some meats are halal. Because undoubtedly meat itself and animals directly and indirectly, not just their flesh but also their company, have a drastic effect on a person's mentality and personality and even character. So if this is the effect that animals have on human beings, even though we don't converse with animals, we don't talk to animals, we don't engage in conversations and discussions with animals, we don't have any ideological or philosophical exchanges with animals, we don't believe that animals have ideas and thoughts that we can learn off from them, we can absorb from them, we can adopt and exchange and share. No, animals are just dumb animals. I don't say dumb, i.e. in terms of not being intelligent, but dumb in being unable to express their feelings and unable to speak to us. So we can't converse with animals. We have no conversations, no exchanges. But just by physically being in the presence of animals, Allahu Akbar, we can either become arrogant or we can become humble and soft, as long as there is prolonged exposure. This is the effect that even animals can have on human beings. So what can be said of the effect that one walking, talking, live, active, interactive human being can have on another human being? We share company, we befriend each other, we talk to each other, we converse with each other, we exchange ideas, we exchange views, we consult one another, we advise one another. One word is sufficient to change a person's entire life, for the better or for the worse. That is how much of a profound and radical influence that one human being can have on another human being. And that is why Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam have told us that we should be extremely careful of the friends that we keep, mindful of the company that we keep. Be in the company of the pious, otherwise remain in solitude. And solitude and loneliness, with all the isolation and the hard feelings and the difficulty, is still better than mixing in bad company. Because when a person mixes in bad company, when a woman has bad company, when a woman has friends who are not exactly religious or pious. Now, what do I mean when I say bad company and good company? You see,